scripture. We're going to try to continue the message of last week in a different form. And so I entitled the message, I just give it the title, Praying, Zion versus Babylon. Zion versus Babylon. So that is the title I give the message. We just read a couple of verses of scripture, and I want you to note a small word here that probably you miss. In verse number 1, the psalmist David said, Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all. I praise God that Jesus Christ paid it all. I thank God that our God is the God of all. He's complete. He said, I am that I am. Our God, the God of His Bible, the God we serve in spirit and truth, don't need anyone. He don't need anything. For He is Jehovah, the Creator, the Almighty God. And that is why He said to Moses, You tell Israel, I am that I am. We sing it, we believe it, that Jesus Christ paid it all. He completed the work on Calvary Cross. We are not the false religion. We are the true children of the living God. We believe the Word of God as it is being preached, as it being penned, inspired by the Holy Spirit. We believe every word in this Bible comes from the living God. That these men were used through the power of the Holy Spirit to pen God's Word. We believe in the biblical account of creation in Genesis, and we can go on, and we believe unto the last word of the book of Revelation. We promise ourselves as God's children that we will stand and we will not add to the Word of God. We promise ourselves that we will not even take from the Word of God. That we will remain in the Word of God, believing that the Word of God is complete. This Word of God is complete, and we need not add and we need not take out. So here we have it. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all, look at the word, all, A-L-L, all that is within me, bless His holy name. We go to verse number 2 and we read, Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all, A-L-L, all His benefits. Everything that I have and everything that I claim that I own come from the Lord. The Lord is my strength. He is my life. He's my light. He is my everything. If I own a business, it is because God has blessed me. If I own a job, it is because God has blessed me. A car, a land, a house. And so I'm reminded every piece of garment that I have, a piece of jewelry and show, everything that I have comes from Thee. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. Every time I eat a piece of bread, I say, thank you, God. I remind it to tell God, thanks. Thank you for the glass of coffee or the cup of coffee and the glass of everything comes from Thee. Listen, I may think that sometimes I am this and I am that, but when I think of the goodness of Jesus, I'm reminded that I am nothing. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all the blessings that I have and everything that I am comes from Thee. And the psalmist David said that. He said, The Lord is my strength. The Lord is my fortress. The Lord is my deliverer. The Lord is my pavilion. The Lord is my love. This guy was so enwrapped with God. And here he's telling us and teaching us, Bless the Lord, O my soul. And let us not forget all His benefits. Then he said in verse 3, Who forgiveth all? Who forgiveth all? All. Look at that. Who forgiveth all thine iniquities? When I trust Christ as my Savior, He didn't forgive me for half of my sins. He forgiveth all my iniquities. Praise be unto God. He removed my transgressions as far as the east is from the west. He said, the Bible said, Who forgiveth all thine iniquities? Who healeth all thy diseases? Wow, praise God. If you have strength, you're strong. God give us the health. God has the power to heal and to cure all the diseases. There isn't anything that was brought to Jesus Christ that He refused or He never had the power to cure. You read the scripture, the lame walk, the blind see, the dead, every kind of diseases, leprosy and all of that came to Him, and He has the power to heal and to cure all manner of diseases. Who healeth all go to many, many prayer, and you go to many beds, you go to people that you think are going to die, and you pray for them, and miraculously, you know it's not you, it has come from God, because miraculously, that person that you think is going to die, received that healing from God, and the person's health was renewed, and now the person is still serving God, praise God. And so the Bible said in verse number 4, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, from destruction. Where would we have been had we not met Christ as our Savior? He redeemeth thy life from destruction. My Redeemer liveth. The name of my Redeemer is Jesus Christ, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercy. Loving kindness and tender mercy. We are serving the God of love, the God that is merciful, gracious, slow to anger. You will read that in the preceding verses. Who redeemeth thy life from destruction. I was on that broad path. I was going on that road to destruction. The things of this world would have destroyed me. I am truly saved by grace. Many times I would say to my wife, many times I would say to friends, had I not met Jesus Christ as my Savior, I would have died, I would have been a gutter, I would have been under a bridge, or somewhere being destroyed already. But praise be unto God that He demonstrates His love and His grace towards me. He redeemeth my life from destruction. He crowneth us with loving kindness and tender mercy. He satisfied my mouth with good things every day. We have so much to eat and to drink. He blessed us with so many different kind of food, different kind of meat, different kind of fruits and vegetables and so forth and so forth. I was just reading about this. This mother was so poor, so very poor, and she was planning to give her, she was planning this lunch to give to her child, and she don't have anything, so she had a piece of bread that was all left that day. And she mentioned the word, and the little girl was standing by listening, and she looked in the kitchen and she said, if only there was a basket of fruits, how rich would I feel myself to be. Basket of fruits, and her daughter heard it. 3 weeks after, somebody gave her a basket of fruits. A neighbor knew that she was going through a hard time, and the neighbor gave to them a basket of fruits. And she put a basket of fruits in the kitchen. And in the morning, when the child woke up, the child ran in and said, "Mama, Mama, come, come, Mama, come. We are rich. We are rich, Mama." And she was thinking, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? We are rich. And she said, "Yeah, Mama, come see, we are rich. Look, Mama, there's a basket of fruits in the kitchen. We are rich." The lady remembered that 3 weeks ago she said, "If only I could have a basket of fruits, how rich I would feel." And she said, "Thank you, God. Thank you for reminding me that a basket of fruits can make me feel rich. A basket of fruits can bring so much joy to my daughter. We are in poverty. We are so poor. But yet still, a basket of fruits can make us rich." Beloved, think about what we have. Think about what we have. Baskets upon baskets upon baskets of fruits. We have so much. And he said, "Who satisfied thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagle." He gave us those baskets of fruits to eat so that we can be strong. We can be strong. We praise God and we thank Him. The Bible tells us that in the book of Numbers, chapter number 11, something happened there that, you know, I was sharing it last week, but I want you to see it this week. If you can't find it, I'll read it for you. In the book of Numbers, chapter number 11, and verse number 4, the children of Israel had so much. They had so much. And although they had so much, they so easily forget how much they had. So the children of Israel, like us, we so soon forget all the benefits that God has bless us with. We so easily forget that our God has blessed us with so much of benefits and blessed us with so much, like the children of Israel we have become in these days. The Bible tells us in verse number 4 in Numbers chapter 11, and the mixed multitude that was among them fell a lusting. That is us, dear. We're always lusting for more. And the children of Israel also wept again and said, who shall give us flesh to eat? Who shall give us flesh to eat? We have so much, and it's like we never satisfy. We want more. We are a generation of more and more and more and more. Sometimes you get up in the morning, or you get up late in the night, and sometimes you're hungry and you're thirsty, and you open that refrigerator. You swing that door and you look, and there are so many things there for you to eat. But you look at all those things and you say, man, why don't we have this? And why don't we have that? There is so many different kinds of stuff in the refrigerator, but your heart lusts for something else. And most of the time, the something else that your heart lusts for is not good for your health anyway. And those are the lusting we have. So Israel went a lusting just like you and I. They were lusting, and they remember, last week I was telling you that, look at what they remember. We remember the fish, which we did eat in Egypt freely. So they remember the fish, number one. They remember the cucumbers, number two. They remember the melons, number three. They remember the leeks, number four. They remember the onions, and they remember the garlic. This morning, as I was reading this, I was thinking I'm going to prepare a message entitled Fish, Cucumbers, Melon, Leeks, Onion, and Garlic. And hope and pray I'll get the opportunity to preach it. But I wonder why these are the things that they remember. There must be a specific reason why these are the six things they remember. There must be. You see, God's word is so powerful. It's so mysterious. It's so inspiring that when you go deeper and deeper, you learn so much. And that is why we never fail to learn. We're all students. You can study and study and study and study, and you will still be a student of the Word of the Living God. There is never a man who could say, I know it all. Never. If he said that, something is wrong with him. Listen, I have met preacher. Literally met them and heard them preach. Ron Comfort, for example, the man memorized his entire life. Do you know how he preached? You should hear this guy preach. This guy preached by quoting so many different verses in one message. It's amazing. He preaches and words of God just popping up. But book, chapter, and verse. Book, chapter, and verse. Because in his testimony he said, I was going blind, the doctor said. And before I go blind, he decided he's going to memorize the Word of God, word for word, from Genesis down to Revelation. Guess what? He memorized almost three-quarters of the Bible, and finally he's still not blind. God used that memorization now for him, so that when he preached, God used him in such a mighty, mighty way. And no man can say that I know the Bible more than anybody. We are all students of the Word of God. And it's wonderful that we can be students of the Word of God. But how easily we forget God's blessings. How easily we forget God's blessings upon our life. The Bible tells us and reminds us in Psalm 103 and verse number 2, what he said, and forget not all his benefits. And forget not all his benefits. We so easily forget God's benefits, and we complain, and we always remember the past. We remember the past, and we forget God's benefits. And when we remember the past, we go about lusting. 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 We forget the benefits of God, and we remember the past. And we remember the drinking, and the partying, and the dancing, and the gambling. And so that is what we lust after. Church. Church. Every Sunday, church. No, man, no, no, no. Listen, I'm going to try to come, but I cannot come every Sunday. I'm going to try to come, but I cannot come every Wednesday. Why? Because I have to have some lusting of my own. I cannot have just church and praising God. There must be some lusting of my own. And so that is what is happening in the world. We give a little here to God, then we go back lusting. Then we give a little here to God, and we go back lusting. We give a little bit to God here, and we go back lusting. The man said, oh wow, I was in church for one Sunday in the month. That's okay. And the other three Sundays is for me. I was in church one Wednesday, or I went to church three times for the year. There are people that do that. I go Christmas, I go Good Friday, and I go Easter. And that's it, they call it. That's it. I've done my duty. We want to go back to the world, the lust of the world, the Bible talks about. The lusting of the world. The lusting of the world. Take a Bible and go into the book of Matthew chapter number 26. And see what happened here. Matthew chapter number 26. I want you to see what will happen when we go about that lusting. That lusting. Matthew chapter 26. We read. We read in verse number 34. Jesus said unto Peter, verily I say unto you, that this night, before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. Look carefully what Peter said. Peter said unto him, though I should die with thee, though I should die with thee, yet will I not deny thee. Likewise also said all the disciples. We read on. We read on in verse number 69. In verse number 69, the Bible tells us here. Now Peter sat without in the palace. Peter was in the wrong place. See that? When you go about lusting, you end up where? At the wrong place. You end up where? With the wrong crowd. With the wrong crowd. Have you ever been in that situation and you're thinking, whoa, what am I doing here with these people? How far can I really be? It happened to me. I'm guilty of that. I was a young Christian years ago. Young Christian. And instead of going to a church Sunday morning where I should be with my wife and children, we had one child then. You know where I was? A Hindu wedding. I was at a Hindu wedding. You know what I was doing? I went back. I lost him. How can I go to church that Sunday? When a friend was getting married? What was going on in the marriage? The past, the drinking, the dancing, the Indian music, and all the friends and dear. You went back to the lusting. There I was, dancing and drinking. At the lusting. At the lusting. You know what happened? After the church service, the pastor then came to me. He didn't wait for a Monday or Sunday afternoon. After the church service, the guy was right at the wedding. He just knew it. And I thank God he came. Today, if I show up at people's place, they're angry to see me. They don't want to see me. I was angry with him, but years later I realized, praise God, he came. He came, he stood in front of the wedding. And everybody knew he came to me. I felt so embarrassed. What is this guy doing in front of a wedding? He shouldn't be here, he should be in his church. Everybody knew he came for me because everybody knew I was going to the church. So I walked out. I was angry with him for being there and coming to say anything to me. This is what he said. He said, you looked me straight in my eyes and said, "You have caused the Hindus to win again." And he rode off with his bicycle. Do you know what that did to me? I still remember it. Do you know how many years that was? Do you know how many years that was? Over 29 years? I still remember it. The Holy Spirit of God caused me to remember that. Do you know what I said? I was never happy back at the wedding. I wasn't. It's like the Spirit of God was haunting me with the words. I left, came home, and I promised myself, the Hindu will not win another time. This is not going to happen. They're not going to win. And every day, I fight that fight. I'm not perfect. Every day, we fight that fight. The battle to go back, or the battle to stay. The battle to go back, or the battle to stay. When you go back, like I said last week, it will bring tears. Here is Peter. He is at the wrong place with the wrong group of people. And the Bible said, now Peter sat without in the palace, and a damsel came, a young girl came unto him, saying, "Thou also was with Jesus of Galilee." You were one of his disciples, you were one of the followers. We had a case in Oregon. Are you a Christian? Stand up. What did Peter do? He denied, verse number 30, 70, sorry. In Matthew chapter number 26 and verse number 70. But he denied before them all, saying, "I know not what thou sayest." I don't know this man. I am not a Christian. He denied. And when he was gone out, verse number 71, into the porch, another maid saw him and said unto him that were there, "This fellow was also with Jesus of Nazareth." This fellow was also with Jesus. Look at the verse number 32. And again he denied. Look at that. You see how the denial become more strong? The first denial was not that strong. The first denial, he said, "I know not what thou sayest." Look at the word. That is the first denial. The second denial becomes even more strong. Look at what he did. The second denial, he said, and he denied the second time with an oath. He denied the second time with an oath, more emphasizing, I do not know the man. And after a while came unto him they that stood by and said to Peter, "Surely thou art one of them, for thy speech betrayed thee." Then, look at the third denial, become even more. You see? Then began he to what? Curse. The third denial become more serious to him. He is denying it more with more emphasis. You see that? He's denying this denial with more zeal and emphasizing more. Then began he to curse and to swear. He's cursing now and he's swaying. He went back into Babylon. He denied that. He denied with curse and swear, saying, "I know not the man. I know not the man." Beloved, look at what happened. The Bible tells us. And Peter remembered the word of Jesus. The word of Jesus. If you're truly saved by God's grace, even when you go back, the Holy Spirit of God will convict you. The Holy Spirit of God will torment you. The Holy Spirit of God will cause something in your heart. Even when you are there with these friends, Peter went back and he remembered the word of Jesus, which said unto him, "Before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice." And looking for the latter part of the verse, and he went out and wept bitterly. He went out and wept bitterly. You will read and Peter writing that he's the only one that used this word in the New Testament. Listen to what he said. Peter said that when you go back, you become like a dog. Listen carefully. Read it for yourself when you get home. In 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 22, this is what Peter said. When you go back, you become like a dog that licks his own vomit. Have you ever seen that? A dog vomit. It's not a good sight. The dog vomit, and now the dog is eating his own vomit. Peter understand what it was to go back. And Peter wrote these words. He said, you will become like a dog that returned to his own vomit. You see, Peter learned a lesson. He wept. He went out and he wept bitterly. But Peter learned his lesson. Some of us will never learn. Some of us will never learn. That's the way we are. We think we know it all. And we are not humble to learn anything. We don't have that humility to learn. We always think that we know and we are strong. We have too much pride in our heart. And that is why we read in Psalm 137, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down and remember Zion. And what they were doing, we wept. We wept. We were crying. Peter wept bitterly. But Peter learned his lesson. He learned his lesson. And we read it again and again and again in Psalm 137. And I hope and pray that you will memorize these words and it will be in your heart as you walk this walk with Jesus. And you will hear these words in your heart. Have it pen in your heart. He said, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, yea, and we wept. We wept. Why? Because we remember Zion. I explained last week to you what was the picture of Zion. Zion's safety. Zion, God blessing. Zion, God heaven. Zion, we remember Zion. What is there to remember about Zion? It was the city of David, the stronghold of Jerusalem. It was where the Ark of the Covenant rested. It was a city of worship. It was a city of restoration. It was a place that you want to go to feel the presence of God. It was a city of promise. It was a city of the redeemed. Zion, it was the city of God. The city of God. And here they said, we sat down at Babylon and we wept. We wept because we remember Zion. But we are not in Zion. We are not in Zion. But we remember Zion. But we are not in Zion. We have our hearts. We hang our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. The instrument that was supposed to play to glorify God. For they that carried us away, captive, we are carried away in chains. In chains. Captivity. The Bible tells us Jesus came to set the captive free. To break the chains that is upon you and I. And if the Son shall set you free, you shall be free indeed. Why do you want to go back to bondage? Why is it we always want to go back to bondage when we are set free? Set free. Remember when Lazarus was raised from the dead and he came up and everybody was standing there? You know what Jesus said?